Today we want to talk about monetary policy and the Federal Reserve's monetary policy tools. We had a formula where the M1 money supply is equal to two things multiplied by each other, the monetary base, and that which is the Federal Reserve's liabilities, and those liabilities are either being held currently by the public as their currency or by being held by bankers as reserves. Okay. The alternative, or the other part of this formula, is the M1 multiplier, that monetary base multiplied by, do you remember the formula? 1 plus the currency deposit ratio divided by currency deposit ratio plus reserve deposit ratio, okay, is the multiplier. And so the money supply goes up and down with changes in the monetary base or changes in the M1 multiplier. What I told you is this, or what I mentioned last time, is that changes in the money supply result from three Federal Reserve policies. Two of those policies affect the monetary base, and one of the policies affects the M1 multiplier. Okay, so we always have to be able, if we say, oh, the Federal Reserve's got a policy that affects the money supply, how does it do it? Does it affect the monetary base, or does it affect the M1 multiplier? Okay, so anyway, let's get started with those. The first policy, and by far the most important one, is called open market operations. Definition: Fed purchases or sales of securities, usually from banks. It doesn't have to be from banks, but typically it would be banks that the Fed's doing business with. Okay? What does this affect? It affects the monetary base. And I'll explain how in just 1 second. Okay. Suppose the Federal Reserve, I'll play the part of the Federal Reserve in our little story here. Suppose the Federal Reserve comes to some banker and says, hey, I'd like to buy $1 million worth of treasury bonds from you. Where it says securities in our definition here, those securities, usually treasury bills, treasury notes, treasury bonds, sometimes also agency bonds, the GSEs, the Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, so forth types of bonds. Okay, so suppose the Federal Reserve comes to some bank and says, I'd like to buy $1 million worth of bonds from you. The banker says, okay. So the banker hands them, and of course there's a negotiation on the price. The banker hands the bonds to the Federal Reserve, and the Federal Reserve says, I'll pay you. Would you like to have some vault cash, or would you like me to just add something to your reserve account? And the banker is going to say, normally, reserve account. And so, to come back over to our formula here for the monetary base, bank reserves are going to be affected. The Federal Reserve is going to credit that bank's reserves. That's when the Fed is purchasing government securities from the private sector. Okay? The alternative would be the Federal Reserve could go to a banker and say, hey, I want to sell you some bonds. And of course, with negotiation and so forth, the banker says, okay. The Federal Reserve says, here's the bond. I'm selling it to you. The Federal Reserve delivers the bond into the hands of the banker and then says to the banker, now you have to pay. You pay, we are going to wipe some dollars, $1 million, let's say, off your reserve account. And then bank reserves will go down. And if bank reserves go down, that feeds through to the monetary base. To go back again, the monetary base is the Fed's liabilities, what it's put into the system, and those funds that the Federal Reserve puts into the system, they could end up as currency held by the public, or they could end up as bank reserves. Either way, if you take a dollar bill of your currency and you give it to the bank, and the bank puts that in a vault, then that currency all of a sudden becomes bank reserves. And so these dollars, these funds injected by the Federal Reserve could be used either way, either as bank reserves or as currency. So, anyway, and most all bank reserves are held at the Fed. They are held in this electronic version or form, I should say. Okay, so anyway, you got it. Open market operations, purchases or sales of securities, usually treasury securities, sometimes the government, the GSE securities, and then government-sponsored enterprise securities, and then it affects the monetary base, and bank reserves is really what we're talking about here. The banker says, oh, that affects my reserves, and then we say, we economists say, well, bank reserves are part of the monetary base. Okay, questions about this? This is the Federal Reserve's most commonly used policy. What's that mean? I mean this. The Federal Reserve is buying or selling government securities every day or two. Or three. But they don't go for a week or two and not buy or sell any government securities. It's an ongoing, it's a constant sort of thing. Okay. A little bit of history, and then I'll come back and talk about this a little bit more. These open market operations were discovered by accident. In, I don't know, 1920 more or less. It wasn't like one day. But let me kind of tell you a brief little story of what was going on. What I said about the Federal Reserve the other day is this, is that the Fed has its own budget. And so each one of the Federal Reserve banks, you know, we have 12 of them, if we go back to before 1920, each one of the Federal Reserve banks would say, well, gosh, we have salaries to pay. We've got utility bills to pay and so forth. We have expenses. And so what these Federal Reserve banks would do is they would go out and purchase a few government bonds from banks. And they would say something like, oh, we'll buy some bonds from you. This is not a big deal. We'll buy some bonds from you, and then we'll just credit your account here at the Fed. And the banker would say, okay. And so the Federal Reserve Bank of, you name it, Minneapolis, would accumulate a few bonds and then credit the reserve account of the bank. And then what would happen is that Federal Reserve Bank would have those bonds, and then every 6 months, the government would pay interest. And then this Federal Reserve Bank said, oh, we have some interest coming in. Now we have revenues and we can pay our bills. We can pay salaries, wages. And they didn't think of it as anything deeper than that, just accumulating some assets that earn some interest so they can pay their bills. And there are 12 of these Federal Reserve Banks and they're all doing the same thing. Okay, at their own pace, at their own time. And sometimes they'd say, well, you know, we have more interest than we need, and so to pay our bills, and we don't, it's not like we need to earn a profit, and so what we'll do is we'll sell a few of these bonds off. And so they were sort of, not very actively, but they were managing their portfolio of bonds to just basically earn some interest income. And so what would happen is this, is the 12 Federal Reserve Bank presidents, and they were called governors then, but these 12 Federal Reserve Bank presidents would meet, have little meetings, and they would just talk about what they were doing. And then the New York Federal Reserve said, you know, all of you are doing this. You're buying and selling your own bonds. And the bond market is in New York. Why don't you all just kind of get together and send, not get together, but why don't you just communicate with us and let us know about the bonds you want to buy or sell. And then if three or four of you are buying and four or five of you are selling, maybe a couple of you doing nothing. But what we'll do is we'll mainly have you trade with each other. But then if there are some net purchases by the group, then we at the New York Fed, we'll take those, you know, whatever the number is, the net purchases, and we'll go out and buy those bonds on behalf of the system. Or if there are net sales among the group, we'll make the sales. But we're just doing this because we're there and we have contacts in the bond market and we're always in touch with these banks and so forth. And so we'd just be happy to do that on behalf of everybody, on behalf of the group. And they all said, yeah, that'd be convenient. And like if one Federal Reserve Bank's buying and another one's selling, also we'll know it when we bring all the numbers together. And we could just like switch, you know, the one that wants to buy and the one that wants to sell, we can just let the two of you do business with each other. And they said, okay. So all of a sudden, all of this stuff that used to be like a million here and a million there, buying and selling, just kind of scattered random kind of things, every once in a while there would be, you know, all these numbers would come together and the Federal Reserve Bank of New York would go into the market and execute an exchange or a trade. And let's say that there's a million here and a million there and so forth, but all of a sudden now there's one trade of maybe $20 million, and it would be kind of like one big trade, not a whole bunch of tiny trades. And once there was one big trade, here's what they noticed. It's like on, let's say, Monday, the New York Federal Reserve Bank would go into the market and buy $20 million worth of securities. And then Wednesday or Thursday, what would happen is banks would start paying off the loans they had received from Federal Reserve banks. This is commercial banks would start paying off the loans. And so then these, and this takes time. This is not like something that happened on, you know, like the 15th of the month. But over time, then these discussions, these Federal Reserve, the board members and the presidents of the Federal Reserve banks, they said, you know, that's kind of interesting. What happened was the New York Fed went into the market and bought, let's say, $20 million worth of bonds on a Monday. And then later on in the week, the banks start paying off their loans that they had gotten, the reserves that they're holding that they had borrowed. They start paying off those loans. Where are they getting the reserves to pay off those loans? And then they said, oh, they got those reserves when the New York Fed bought bonds. Oh. So when the New York Fed is buying bonds, it's pushing reserves into the banking system. And that allows them to, the banks to pay off their loans. They were getting reserves by borrowing it from the Fed, but now they don't need to. They got reserves from another source. Huh. So in addition to lending reserves to banks, we could also just buy bonds from banks and put reserves in their hands. Huh. And so, you know, they're just kind of having these conversations and just thinking their way through it and kind of... And then they said, hey, if we want to increase bank reserves, we could just go out and buy bonds. We don't have to just be buying and selling bonds because we want interest income. We can go out and buy and sell bonds because we want to affect bank reserves in some active way. And so open market operations, it took several years, really, among smart people kind of, you know, like feeling their way along and not really knowing where they're headed with all this. And then they figured this out. And then they said, hey, you know, this is not about the Federal Reserve generating interest income. This is about us managing basically banking or monetary and credit conditions of the United States. And so starting in like the late teens and then up over the next 8 or 10 years, then the Federal Reserve got to the point where they said, hey, we can manage money and credit conditions of the United States. Okay, now there's a sad story that ends all this. The guy who knew the most about all this stuff that was the leader of the Federal Reserve was a guy named Benjamin Strong. And he understood open market operations. They didn't have that name for it. He understood open market operations. He's the one that basically explained it to everybody, and he's the one that provided leadership for the Federal Reserve. Okay? And if Benjamin Strong had lived, but he didn't, he died in 1928 of tuberculosis. Had he lived, then I believe that we would have gotten it in 1930 and so forth, and we would have seen that Bank of United States fail, and then there would have been this panic, you know, a bank run and so forth, and then Benjamin Strong would have said, hey, we need to put a stop to that through open market operations. But he was dead by that time, and there wasn't leadership within the Federal Reserve, and there wasn't this knowledge and experience, and so what happened was then the Federal Reserve officials just kind of sat there and they let monetary policy be passive at a time it should have been active. But before the Great Depression, the Federal Reserve had the tools. The knowledge was there on how to manage the money supply. And if banks needed more reserves, how to get the reserves into their hands, not only a loan through the discount window, but also basically buy bonds from bankers. Okay, but that's what this comes down to, buying and selling bonds. And over time, the Fed buys more than it sells. Over time, the monetary base goes up. Okay, and now the Federal Reserve is holding, I don't know, hundreds of billions of dollars worth of treasury bonds, treasury bills, treasury notes, treasury bonds. Okay, but this was all done by accident, and but now it is no longer an accident. In the mid-1930s, something called the Federal Open Market Committee. I told about that, right? I think I put that acronym up there the other day. Federal Open Market Committee, or FOMC, is 7 members of the Board of Governors plus 5 Federal Reserve Bank presidents. So there are 12 members of the FOMC, 12 voting members, I should say. The meetings are attended by the 7 members of the Board of Governors. They are attended by 12 Federal Reserve Bank presidents. They are attended by 1 vice president of the New York Fed, and then whatever advisors and economists within the system they need, they will be attending also. I want to talk, so these are, there will be at least 20 people in the room when they have the FOMC meetings. 12 votes, 7 members of the board, 12 Federal Reserve Bank presidents, and this is a vice president of the New York Fed, and that is the manager of the open market desk. The open market desk is where they actually do the buying and selling of government securities. So the FOMC will have a meeting, and then they will say, here's what we want to do. And these meetings last for a couple days. But at the end, they'll issue this policy directive and say, here's what we intend to do between now and our next meeting. And basically, it'll come down to, we're going to buy some bonds, let's say. And then they say to the manager of the open market desk, did you get that? Did you understand what we're saying? And the manager of the open market desk says, yeah, I got it. No, he doesn't say it. He says, yes, I did understand that. And so I will go out and execute the order that came out of this group. Okay, but somebody has to do it. These people are just like voting on policy, saying, here's what we want to do. Somebody's got to put that into action, and it's the manager of the open market desk in New York. And so this is really the same story I told you a while ago, is about the Federal Reserve discovering by accident this open market operations. These transactions take place in New York. How's this done? Oh, do you have a question?
Who are those 5?
Who are those 5? They are presidents of Federal Reserve banks. And one of them is always the New York president of the New York Fed, always. So this position has been permanently, you know, I told you about Benjamin Strong and how important he was to the Federal Reserve back at the time they discovered open market operations. The New York Fed is where our financial capital is in the United States. That's where our biggest banks have traditionally been headquartered. And so the New York Fed is sort of the regulator of the biggest banks in the United States and plugged into our financial markets. And so that president of the New York Fed is always one of the voting members. And then the other 4 rotate among the remaining 11 Federal Reserve banks, districts. Okay? And by the way, it's, and you don't need to know about this, but sometime there will be, I said 4 votes, 11 Federal Reserve districts. Sometimes it will be 2 Federal Reserve districts trade a vote back and forth every other year. And then for some of them, it's 3 Federal Reserve banks trade a vote, and they'll get that vote once every 3rd year. Don't trade, but it moves. It rotates among the group. But anyway, 4 of the 11 Federal Reserve banks have votes at any point in time, plus always the New York Fed. Okay? So anyway, these people communicate during the meeting. You know, they can just, any of them, say whatever they want to say and have their input. It's just when it comes down to casting a vote, there are 12 votes. How often do they meet? They meet about once every 6 weeks or so. Okay? Which would be about 8 times a year, 7 times a year, maybe 6 sometimes. It just depends. But anyway, they've got a schedule in advance, and we always hear about this before they meet. But about once every 6 weeks they meet. Okay? So here's what happens. The Fed, let's say, purchases securities. I'll say bonds. That's step one. Well, I guess step one is the meeting. And then step two is the Fed purchases bonds. Step three is the Fed credits, bank reserve accounts, right? And then the bank says, hey, bank loans excess reserves. Banks say, hey, we don't have to hold these reserves. We just sold $1 million worth of bonds to the Fed. We've got that $1 million on reserve. Those aren't required reserves. Those are excess reserves. Let's make a loan. And then those loans increase the money supply. Okay. Let's talk about something else they do. Okay. This thing right here, banks loan excess reserves, this increases the supply of credit. And if the supply of credit increases, that decreases interest rates, right? Remember our supply and demand for loanable funds? So we'll shift that supply curve to the right, S2, and then we got a lower interest rate. And you have that on, it's in your textbook. It's talking about an increase in money supply growth depresses interest rates. By the way, let's back up in the process. When the Fed purchases bonds, then the Fed is demanding bonds. So if there's an increase in the demand for bonds, what happens when there's an increase in demand for something? Its price goes up, right? So there's an increase in the price of bonds. And then just this concept that we have of the inverse relationship between bond prices and interest rates. So when the price of bonds goes up, there's a decrease in interest rates. Okay, and this is the concept of interest risk. And so what we can see, and we see it at a couple points in the process here, is interest rates are being depressed by this Federal Reserve policy. So yes, the money supply goes up, but interest rates are going down, and lower interest rates are what stimulate companies to invest more in the economy, you know, to build a factory or buy a delivery truck or get some computers for employees. And lower interest rates stimulate people to go out and buy cars and buy houses and so forth. And so this works its way into the economy. People don't say something like this, oh gosh, did you hear the money supply is up? I'm going to go buy something. What happens is the money supply is going up, and at the same time, there's a greater supply of credit, interest rates are coming down, and so what we see is there's an increase in spending. And that's an increase in aggregate demand. And then what will happen is, with time passage, there will be an increase in the number of jobs, increase in GDP, increase in the price level. And by the way, this is bringing us back to the very beginning of the course, where one of the first things we talked about is how does money affect the economy? And so here we have this FOMC meeting, and if they decide, let's buy bonds, what they are deciding to do, I mean, they're not saying let's buy bonds for fun. They're not saying let's buy bonds because it's our responsibility. They're saying let's buy bonds because we want to stimulate the economy. And so buying bonds, treasury bills, treasury notes, treasury bonds, buying bonds is just the first step in that process of stimulating the economy. It's not done by accident. And these people who are doing this understand all of these links and connections and so forth and what that's going to lead to. And so you'd see the most of these Fed buying bonds in a big way, you'd see that at a time of weakness in the economy. Okay, not at a time where the economy is, let's say, near its peak and there's a lot of inflation and stuff like that, and they go, oh, let's go out and throw more money in the economy. No. This can all be reversed. I'm not going to go through and do it all, but if the Fed says, gosh, we have some inflationary forces here, the economy seems really strong, and there's a lot of inflationary forces at work, let's do the opposite. Let's sell bonds. And if we sell bonds, then their prices will go down and interest rates will go up a little bit. And that'll help slow the economy down. We will take reserves away from banks. The bankers have to pay for these bonds when we sell the bonds. And so we'll reduce bank reserves. Banks will not make loans. They'll do the opposite. When loans expire, you know, or paid off, the banks will just say, well, we're not going to make any more loans. Okay? And then a reduced supply of credit, interest rates will be going up. And then that will decrease spending, slow down basically the economy, lower aggregate demand for goods and services, and slow the economy down. Okay. I guess one thing I did not mention, and I'll just throw it in here very briefly, this Fed buying or selling bonds is done with basically bids. The Federal Reserve will contact a bunch of banks, government securities dealers, and they'll say, we want to buy $1 million worth of bonds. So why don't you banks tell us if you'd like to sell some bonds, and if so, at what price? And so the bankers will submit this information to the Federal Reserve, and the Fed is going to buy $1 million worth of bonds, but going to buy those bonds from the banks that offer them to the Fed for sale at the lowest possible price. The Fed's trying to get a bargain. Okay, so the Fed's going to buy the bonds under competitive conditions. And so they'll get 30 bids, let's say, coming in, and the Fed will rank those prices from cheapest bonds down to the most expensive, and then they'll just go down the list, buy, or purchase these bonds, and then they'll say, yeah, that's all we need. So they don't just contact one bank and say, we want to buy bonds from you. Okay, questions about this? This is the most commonly used policy. It happens all the time. If the Fed had no other policy, that would work out fine. Okay. The second policy the Federal Reserve has, though, it started off with this policy. It was the first policy they had when the Federal Reserve first went into business, and it's discount rate policy. And the definition, change interest rates, let's say interest rate on discount loans. The Fed makes to banks. If you increase the discount rate, then there's a reduction in bank borrowing at the Fed. And vice versa. So if they lower the discount rate, then there'll be more bank borrowing at the Fed. History of this? This was the Fed's first policy. This was the one, when the Fed was created by that law passed in 1913, the Federal Reserve Act, when the Fed was created, this was the first policy they had. If you'll remember, the story is, we'll establish this Federal Reserve, it will hold reserves of bankers, and then if the bankers need reserves, need liquidity, they can borrow it from the Fed. And so the Fed had this discount window. Okay, I'll draw you a little picture because I'm quite the artist. Loans. This is the discount window. And then inside, there was this Fed official, and of course, always kind of grouchy. They got to keep him caged up. And then there's, you know, like 5% or whatever, they'll have an interest rate out there for those loans. And then bankers can come in and get a discount loan. These are the discount loans. And then if there's a loan, that gets added to bank reserves. Okay? And then the bankers say, hey, we can now make some loans. Increase in bank loans. And then that increases the money supply, and then that stimulates the economy. And I just mentioned it a moment ago, for the Federal Reserve to stimulate more discount loans, they need to lower the discount rate. And so if we're going to have this whole process of more loans through the discount window, more bank reserves, more lending, then we need to cut this discount rate, not 5%, let's make it 4%. Are you with me on this deal? It works in reverse. If the Federal Reserve wanted to raise that discount rate from 5 to 6%, then bankers would say, no, I am not borrowing at the discount window. In fact, at 6%, I'm going to pay off the loans I have at the discount window. And so then there would be fewer discount loans. There would be bankers actually paying off their loans at the discount window. Bank reserves would go down. Bankers then would not have the reserves to lend out. And then the money supply would decline, and there would be, that would slow down economic activity. Yes, sir?
Why would that cause the banks to pay off their loans?
Well, because you're paying the interest rate. If you're paying 6%, you say, yeah, I don't want that loan if you're the banker. I don't want that loan at 6%. At 5%, yeah, maybe, but not at 6. And the higher that interest rate goes.
Yeah, so the loans are variable.
Pardon me? When you get a loan from the Fed, then basically it's a fairly short-term loan, and then it gets repriced at this new interest rate. And so like a couple weeks, we'll make you a loan for a couple weeks at 5%, and you can pay it off if you want, and then that's the end of it. But if you want to keep those reserves, you have to start paying at the new discount rate. Okay? So anyway, now, here's the thing, though. Oh, before I tell you, here's the thing. Let me just say, the banks, how many banks do we have as member banks? Anybody remember the number? How many? I think it was about 2,300, wasn't it? We had 1,600 national banks and then another 700 or so Fed member banks that had state charters. So what we have are these Federal Reserve districts, 12 of them, and the member banks within the district, that's who has the common everyday right to go to the Fed and borrow at the discount window. Other banks can in certain circumstances. But anyway, so you borrow at the discount or at the Federal Reserve Bank that you're a district. Banks borrow from their district Federal Reserve Bank. So anyway, there are 12 Federal Reserve Banks. Each one sets its own discount rate. And so we've got two Federal Reserve Banks in Missouri, so if Kansas City decides we're going to raise our discount rate and St. Louis says we're not, in theory, that can be done. And so each Federal Reserve Bank sets its own discount rate for the banks in their district. Now, they do have to go back and get this okayed by the Board of Governors, but they'll have a reason for saying they want to do this, and so they apply for this, and in many cases, either they will all talk it out and say, nah, it's probably not the best idea after all, or, okay, go ahead. And so these discount rates aren't all the same. But anyway, so we've got each Federal Reserve has got its own discount rate. Banks do some borrowing through the discount rate. I want to add one more thing before I go on because it occurred to me just now. This is the discount rate. This is a different meaning from the discount rate we used back when we had the present value formula. There's the future dollars and 1 plus I to the T power, if you'll remember, and I call that the discount rate. That is a discount rate, and it has a totally different meaning, and you're supposed to know that from the context. Now we're talking about the discount rate the Federal Reserve sets on its loans to bankers, and that's a different discount rate, so don't be confused by these two terms. Yes, sir?
Can banks have to go to their federal?
They have to go to their own Federal Reserve Bank. That's right. You can't say, you know, I'm in the Kansas City Federal Reserve District, but they're charging 0.25% less over there in the St. Louis District. I'm going to go over there. What if you're a bank in each district? Well, where's your headquarters? Where's your headquarters? Yeah. So, because that's a branch over there, right? Anyway, if you have a separately chartered bank, let's say you're a bank holding company and you have two banks and they are separately chartered, then each bank goes to its own Federal Reserve. Okay, if you're a bank holding company and you've got a bank in, let's say, the Minneapolis district and another in the Chicago district, each one of those banks with their own charters can go to their own Federal Reserve Bank.
Can one bank loan money to the other bank at 0% interest or
not? I don't know. Don't make me lower your grade. I don't have the answer to that, but very imaginative. So one bank would go to two banks within the same banking group, is that what you're saying? One of them goes over here and borrows some money from its Federal Reserve Bank at 0.25% less and then lends the money to the other one. I guess you can probably get by with that. The only thing is, and I'll get to this later, when a banker comes to the discount window, you see this guy with a frown, when a banker comes to the discount window and says, "Hi, could I have a loan?" The first couple times they go, "Yeah." And then they say, "What's the problem? How come you're always in here?" And you say, "Oh, you know, just wanted to borrow some money. I noticed you're charging 5% or whatever." And they go, "Why don't you get all your books? Come on in. We'll kind of get a conference room emptied out. We'll have a sit down and have some lunch and talk it over and see if we can't help you manage your bank a little bit better so you're not in here all the time." And then you say, "No, no." And so anyway, that whole theory about borrowing, you know, and then lending some other bank to save 0.25% interest, that's not going to happen, is it? You're going to have to say something? Oh, they could just have different credit conditions, you know, in their own district. And it may be that part of the economy is a little more overheated and another part of the economy is not so overheated. And the one that is overheated, they might say, you know, we need to kind of slow down lending in this district a little bit. Yes, sir?
Can they say no to a bank?
Can they say no? Well, they can say no. Usually what they do, it's sort of like borrowing money from your parents, you know, like when you say, "Oh, I want to borrow some money," and your parents say, "Yeah, come on in here and let's have a sit down." Then after a while you go, "No, I'll just go rob a convenience store or something. I'd like to avoid this whole discussion." Anyway, and so I don't think we actually say that. But the point is that it doesn't usually get to the point of saying no. Let me illustrate what I'm saying with a very short story. I went to the Federal Reserve, the econ department here, got together, I don't know, maybe 10 years ago, and we went to the Federal Reserve Bank, and we got like a tour through there, and they were showing us all the different departments and introducing us to people, and some of their economists there came out and made presentations. So we were in this room, and I don't know, like on the 7th floor, the 8th floor, or something like that, and it was a pretty big, I mean, maybe 35 feet by 20 feet wide, pretty big room, and it had glass walls all the way around it. And there was this big table. And so we're all sitting at the table, you know, around the table, and there's some economist, and he's up here, and he's making a presentation. And so I noticed this. I don't know, maybe I'm the bad student in the room, but rather than just focus on that, I'm kind of looking around, you know. And so what had happened is, like, the elevator doors would open up, and then some people, two or three people, would step out of the elevator, and they're going someplace. But what would happen is they would walk around this big glass room, and as they're going around the room, they would look in there. You know, like, this is the most fascinating, just like people visiting a zoo or something like that, and you're looking at the monkeys in the zoo, or, I mean, there's something fascinating. And I can tell this because, like, 50 people, that's all they do is they come out of the elevator and they walk around and they're looking in there. And so after this, we've been there for 20, 30 minutes or something like that, and they said, "Any questions?" And so I put my hand up and I said, "You know, this is all very fascinating and so forth, but I'm kind of curious about these people because I said the doors open and people come out and they're going someplace else, but they're just really fascinated what's going on in here. Why do they keep looking at us like that? And the guy says, oh, this is the room where we meet with bankers that are in some kind of trouble. You know, like it may be that they're experiencing a lot of losses or they're breaking some rules or something like that. And he said, we bring like a few bankers in, I mean, from a bank, but like maybe the board of directors of the bank or some of the officers. But we talk to them in this room, and what they are looking to see is if any of you are crying. Because this is where the bankers are told that they have lost their jobs or lost their bank, or they are being punished in some major way, and this is where the stressful situation, and so they were looking to see who's crying. Well, no, none of us are crying. But, so what I'm saying to you is this, to go back to the story. This guy's got a frown on his face, because there's a lot of frowning that occurs. And this is, the Federal Reserve says it like this, this is a privilege to borrow here. Don't abuse it. Okay, so if something comes up and you need to borrow at the Fed, at the discount window, come on in. But if you just say, oh gosh, I can borrow from you at 4% or whatever rate, and everybody else is charging 6%, and you're borrowing from us to save 1% or 2%, that's not what this is for. And then you're kind of abusing the privilege. And so if you go in there and borrow, they just say, of course, here you go. And then you go in again, you know, a month later or whatever, and say, you want to borrow? Of course, here you go. And then you go in there a little bit later and say, I want to borrow. They say, you know, I think what we need to do is have a little sit down in the big glass room. And then you say, no, 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 that's okay. I'll just go rob a convenience store. Not really, but who do you borrow from? If you'll remember, we had that little picture up here before. And there's the dollars coming in from different sources. There's the deposits. And number two, borrowing. Borrowing from banks. Federal Reserve Bank borrowing from another bank in the Fed funds market. Most of these banks that need to borrow do not borrow from the Fed. They borrow from another bank. And so what I started to tell you a moment ago, and I need to throw in a couple little sidebars here, but what I started to tell you a while ago is this. Not much gets borrowed through the Federal Reserve discount window in normal times. If you just look over the last 30 years and just look at the average week over, you know, the last 30 years and just look at the numbers, then there might be like $1 billion, and I'm just throwing a number out there, there might be $1 billion borrowed through the discount window. And you know, $1 billion is a lot for me or you. But when we're talking about a banking system that deals in trillions of dollars, that's nothing. It gets rounded off to zero. And so most of the money that the federal, that these banks borrow are borrowing from other banks, okay, the Fed funds market. And this is a little bit unusual. And go ahead. The Fed funds rate is in the neighborhood of the same interest rate. And so like if, think about it again, as if you had a chance and you could borrow it from your best friend or you could borrow the money from your parents, then just borrow from the best friend, right? And the parents don't need to know about this. They'll find out soon enough. Okay? Anyway, here's bank reserves. So if I go back to that formula, then changes in the discount rate affect bank reserves or the monetary base. Okay, this is currency holdings plus bank reserves. And so when the Federal Reserve changes the discount rate, then it's affecting the amount of bank borrowing of reserves and therefore the monetary base. All of this stuff that I sketched out here, these links, these connections are true, but small and fairly insignificant. The biggest reason the Federal Reserve has for changing this discount rate is not for affecting the economy. The biggest reason they have to change that discount rate is basically because the news people, the newspaper, the magazines, the TV news, they pay attention. And so if the Federal Reserve lowers this rate, that evening at 6 o'clock or whatever time the news comes on, you say, hey, the Federal Reserve lowered the discount rate today. And that is important. This means they are stimulating the economy. Well, yeah, And basically, that's the Federal Reserve's, and they call this an announcement effect. That's the announcement effect. This is the way the Fed has of telling everybody we're stimulating the economy. But the actual stimulus is small. And then what they'll do is follow up by open market operations. They'll buy some bonds from bankers, and then the actual reserves enter the economy. And yeah, they're stimulating the economy, but this is the announcement effect. And if they raise that discount rate, there's the announcement effect of we're trying to slow the economy down. But the true slowing down of the economy will occur through open market sales. The third policy the Federal Reserve has is changes in the required reserve ratio. By the way, this is Regulation D. We talked about Regulation Q before. The Federal Reserve has all the whole alphabet taken up with regulations. Well, more than the alphabet, they start over. AA. Anyway, so here's what happens is if the Federal Reserve, who makes this policy? This policy is made by the Board of Governors, the seven members of the Board of Governors. Okay, this policy almost never gets changed. The last time, and I think we know this, that there's a 3% or a 10% required reserve ratio. It only applies to checking deposits, not the savings or time deposits. But at small banks, the required reserve ratio is 3% on checking deposits. And at medium-sized and large banks, it's 10. These rates were set in 1992, I believe. And so these, and I don't know if they'll ever change it again. Maybe they will, but I have no idea when. No doubt they'll change it someday. Here's the way it works. Let's say that this ratio is 10%. Somebody makes a deposit. I walk into the bank, I say, here's a deposit, $1,000. The banker says, okay, I'll set aside 10% of that $1,000. Those are required reserves, $100. The rest is excess reserves, $900, I'll make a loan. And that loan goes to money supply, right? That's how the money supply expands. Banks make loans. If we raise that required reserve ratio from 10% to 20, then I put in the same $1,000 deposit, the banker sets aside $200, and now can only make a loan of $800. So that same deposit gives rise to a smaller expansion of the money supply. So here's what we have. Increase in the required reserve ratio. Let me just use two R's here. This is required reserves, not just reserves, but required reserves as a percent of deposits. If that ratio goes up, then there's a reduction in bank lending. And that corresponds to a reduction in the M1 multiplier. And then that would decrease the money supply, and then it would basically slow down the economy. This doesn't happen much, and I don't know when it will happen again. By the way, yes, all the ratios or the arrows can be turned around. Lower required reserves, more bank loans, higher money multiplier, bigger money supply, stimulate the economy. I think we've come to the end of another stimulating discussion on Federal Reserve policy. That's what we're going to talk about next time. So long.